Well, good morning and welcome to Crossroads Church. We are so glad that you have joined us on this beautiful spring day, the sunny Sunday morning. We are excited. We are kicking off a new message series this week called Fixer Upper. And no, I was unable to get the gangs to join us. So if you are tuning in today and you were expecting the home improvement, the people that flip houses, I guess you're going to have to talk to a different handyman this week. When I was looking at the text for today, one of the things that helps us increase our curb appeal is making sure that we have our hearts aligned with the things that God desires. And I came across this psalm that I want to share with you this morning. Psalm 37, verse 3 and 4 says, "Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart." We invite you to stand and to join us this morning as we begin our worship service.
Well, good morning, everyone. Great to see you all here. What a beautiful day. I would like to say a quick prayer here as we get going. Heavenly Father, we welcome you into this place, Lord. We ask for your presence here as we worship you with open hearts and open minds. And we just give you this morning for your glory, honor, and praise. Amen.
Thank you. sentence together and you're just a little off, right? And then we sing a song like this and we're just reminded that it was never about us to begin with. It is about our God. Will you continue to worship with me as we go to the Lord in prayer? Gracious and loving God, we give you praise. We seek you, Father. We seek you in this place and we know that your presence is here. We know that you have come to meet with us. Lord, you have come to speak to us. You have come to show us. And as we just sang about, as we just worshiped you, God, you are the one who is more than enough. You are the one who covers us. You're the one who gives us the grace. You're the one whose mercies are new every morning. And so, God, we come to gather, whether in person or online, to worship you, to turn to you, to seek you first. God, to look to you. So we come with different places. We come with different burdens. We come with different joys. We come from different parts of our journey. And Lord, we come and we bring it all before you. And we lay it at the foot of your cross. And we know that you transform us. You take whatever we're going through. You take whatever we're walking through. And you're the one who makes us new. So God, we thank you for that. We look to you. We seek you first. And we praise you this morning. We worship you in this place. Because God, you are the one who is more than enough. You are the one that we need. Thank you. In your precious name, we pray. Amen. Amen.
brief announcements with you this morning before I go ahead and invite our storyteller to come up and to share our children's moment. First off, I want to say thank you so much for joining us today for worship. We are glad that you are here. If you are tuning in online or if you want to interact with our online audience, my question of the day, if you want to greet one another, is what is your greatest fish story? What's your biggest fish story? And you'll notice I put that in quotation marks here, because if you know a good fisherman or not so good fisherman, we always have our great stories about the one that got away, right? So go ahead, share a fish story, probably after the service. If you're here present, want to share a fishing opener story, go ahead and do so. I also want to encourage you to stay generous. I want to thank you so much for supporting Crossroads Church. You can give online at elkinmarketchurch.com/give, or you can go ahead, if you are here present and want to place an offering in our wooden offering box on the way out, you may do so as well today. Our missions for the last month and a half or so has been to raise funds for camping scholarships, and I was looking over the camping report that we get from the conference so far, and I think we have about 10, 15 people that have expressed interest and have registered for camp, and looking at that, we have about $800 to $1,000 that we're looking to try to raise. If we could hit that goal, it would be great. We could cover camp for some that have not been able to pay it in full yet, and what a blessing it would be to be able to say, here's a camping scholarship. We are so glad that you are going to camp. We want to help you out. Of course, our conference has some funds to help it, because we believe that nobody should be turned away from going to camp simply for financial reasons. And so, Cheryl, I'm not going to put you on the spot. All right, I won't put you on the spot today to ask how much we've raised so far for missions. But if you'd like to contribute to camping scholarships, you can do so on the same channels as well. Also, we are kicking off a new small group with our Fixer Upper series. Now, when I was talking to one of our people last week, they had asked, like, hey, is this going to be like a small group where we travel around and fix each other's houses? Like, that might be a great idea. I'm looking out there and I see some great skills in here, but we are not doing like a fixing up of the house small group, although maybe we should, because we're hosting it at our place, and I have a few projects on my list that could get knocked off. But we are going to be hosting a small group Sunday evenings, 5:30 p.m. We're going to go ahead and grill something. Maybe people can bring a side salad or a dessert. We'll probably hang out on the deck if the weather's nice and just really enjoy a beautiful evening of being able to connect and enjoy some fellowship and as we kind of talk about our sermon series, as we talk about our relationships. And so that starts next Sunday, 5:30 p.m. Also, then the Sunday of June 6th, we're going to be doing kind of a mixing event. If you are tuning in online or you are here in person, we want to invite you to join us at Shortstop Nutrition over by the Newmarket Bank in the Commerce Center, and we're going to have a Shake It Up Sunday. So I was talking to Stacy Sampus, one of our online attendees, and said, hey, what if we do an event here where we'll buy some shakes in bulk and people can come and sample the shakes, and we can just have a great mixer event where we can enjoy a little time of fellowship and a wonderful treat as well. So that is coming up Sunday, June 6th. With that, I'm going to invite Randy to come forward and to share our story with us this morning.
Today we're going to be celebrating two stories here. First of all, the one will be, it might be true, who knows? We are out talking today about curb appeal. That usually refers to a home and how it appears to others as they pass by. It's neat and clean around, there are flowers planted, and everything looks pleasant and inviting. It has appeal. There was a lady named Madeline who just seemed always to be upset about something. Madeline usually did not have good curb appeal. People didn't much like being around her, of course. And so when anyone was complaining, someone would say, oh, you must be having a Madeline day. We all have days when nothing seems to go right. People don't like to be around unhappy people. We don't like feeling that way either. On days like that, our curb appeal isn't very appealing. Have you ever been there? It might be true, who knows? The second story we're going to look at is, we know it's true, it's in the Bible. Let's take a look at our Bible here. Open up Jonah chapter 2, verses 6 through 9. Do you remember Jonah? The guy in the whale of a lot of trouble? Well, poor old Jonah was certainly having some maddling days. He didn't like the idea of going on to Nineveh, those evil people, as God was asking him to do. So he ran away. But that didn't work, because he found himself on a boat in a storm and ended up in the smelly belly of a whale. That would have been the ultimate battling day, right? Instead of the whole story of Jonah, let's look at chapters 2, 6 through 9 right now. So verse 6, we'll begin with, let's read. I went down to the moorings of the mountains. The earth, with its bars closed behind me forever. Yet you have brought me up my life from the pit. O Lord my God, my soul fainted within me. I remembered the Lord, and my prayer went up to you, into your holy temple. Those who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy. But I will sacrifice to you with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay what I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. In the belly of the whale, scared to death, Jonah began to think about his attitude. He had to do something about his curb appeal. It was there in that smelly belly he realized that God had not abandoned him. So what did he do? He began to thank God for the blessings, and that is when God spewed him out into the land safe. When he finally realizes that God is on his side and goes to Nineveh, everything changes. The people repent, and Jonah was a changed man. The next time you are feeling like Madeline or Jonah, stop and count your blessings and turn to God. Together, you can change your curb appeal. We know it's true. It's in the Bible.
Thank you, Ray. So one of the things that I love about the house that we moved into a couple years ago was the outside spaces. When we were looking at the house, I really enjoyed the thought of this nice big yard on the corner lot where I could envision all the neighborhood kids coming over to play some ball or go ahead and play some football or soccer in the backyard. There was this trampoline that some of you have been to the house and have seen that trampoline where it's really easy to get up onto and the kids have a great time jumping and enjoying the backyard. There was a playhouse for Tears and her friends with a little sandbox that we refilled with sand underneath, and I was just admiring this wonderful yard. Of course, there was this generous deck that I could envision having all of you over, maybe not all at once on the deck, but enjoying a little barbecue on the back deck there, or enjoying the patio, which is this huge concrete patio, which is large enough for me to put my small above-ground swimming pool on. And so I loved these outdoor spaces. It was one of the huge things that the house seemed to have some curb appeal when we were looking at it. You remember what it was like that first time you looked at your house? But once we moved in and we started to unpack some of those last boxes, well, some of that curb appeal kind of quickly fades, doesn't it? And I started to notice some things that maybe I didn't notice before. There was a tree in the front yard that was a little bit sick, and so despite my best efforts to trim off the branches that were diseased, Eventually, I found all I was left with was a stump, and even that wasn't healthy enough to leave there. And so we tore the whole tree out. We made some changes to the landscaping, and our neighbors probably wondered what on earth we were going to do when they saw the very first dump truck show up and dump a huge mound of black dirt in their backyard, followed by another one and another one. Actually, we brought in 8 loads of dirt to replant and to redo our backyard and try to level it out a little bit, which the kids, as you can see here, really enjoyed the fact that we had a very wet summer that year. So they had fun playing in the bed and mud, and they may have been sprayed down a few times with the garden hose before coming back into the house. It's still a work in progress, I guess you could say, but it feels like we are getting a little bit closer to our goals. And the affirmation that our neighbors have shared of just saying, hey, we really appreciate the efforts. We can kind of see you're trying to do something here. I don't know if that was an encouragement to, like, why don't you, like, finish up? Like, hey, when are you going to do something about that mud there? Because it's tracking into my house when my kids come over to play. I don't. But having that affirmation felt good. That at least they appreciated the curb appeal that we were after. Now, maybe having a nice, healthy lawn is more of the guy thing in the house. But we all desire to have a place with curb appeal, don't we? A place that feels good to be able to come home to a place that you love, a place that you enjoy being. Right? We are often enamored with our first look at our house, but we know that eventually we start to see those little cracks that showed up in the wall. And there was that stain in the carpet that you never seemed to notice before. And well, who knew that the appliance was going to go out the first time you used it? Or maybe your dishwasher never really washes the dishes, and so you end up doing them by hand before and after running the dishwasher, right? We all have those quirks of a little fixing up to do. And eventually that curb appeal tends to fade if we don't stay on top of it. And we may even begin to wonder, is now a good time to think about something else? Is now a good time to make a move? I understand the housing market is hot. Tom, can I put you on the spot? What did you say? There's like 4? Were you told there were 4 buyers for every house on the market right now? And with the insanity like that that's out there, you might be tempted to be like, hey, you know what? Maybe now is a really good time to put my house on the market. I can make a lot of money, right? But just because the housing market might be hot doesn't mean we need to give up on the dream, does it? It's not like we abandon the dream that we had for our home and our place simply because it seems like it's nice. Right? And maybe that place over there looks really nice. And maybe you've checked out a few places that have been listed online and you think about, wow, this would be really, really nice. And what you start dreaming a little bit, right? And it always seems like the grass is greener on the other side, right? But here's the deal. I kind of made this image myself. While the grass may be greener on the other side, we don't always see what the dog left behind, do we? I think you get the point. We don't always see why the grass is as green as it seems on the outside from the street. But if we come up close and we start examining, we might not like what we find. You see, the reality is we all have a little fixing up we can do in our lives, don't we? We all have those places of our lives. Our homes could use a little work. And I'm not just talking about the paint of the walls or that flooring that needs to be replaced. I'm talking about the homes that we create with the people that we love. With our friends, with our neighbors, with our family members, with our children, our grandchildren, our spouse, right? We all have a little fixing up we can do. And maybe you're here today and you're thinking, you know what? That curb appeal, it's been a while. It's started to fade. And your relationship doesn't seem quite as vibrant as it once was. A few weeds have sprung up in the yard, and the grass isn't as healthy and lush as it once was. And well, let's be honest, we all could use a little fresh coat of paint, right? Well, if you've ever wondered, how do I know if my relationship needs a little fixing up? How do I know if I should pay attention to this series or this message? Let me run through a little list I've found. Number one, you have stopped listening. Some of you have stopped listening right now. No, we don't. But you know what I mean, right? We stopped listening. It's not so much like we kind of missed what they said, but it's kind of like we no longer care what they said, right? It's kind of a difference of my heart of hearing or selective hearing sometimes, but you reach that point where it's like, you know what? I already know what they're going to say. I don't need to listen to them because I already know exactly what they're thinking. Number two, you're emotionally cheating. Maybe you haven't necessarily had a physical affair, but you've kind of emotionally checked out of the relationship. And instead, you have more emotional gratification in some other relationship, maybe with a family member or a coworker. Number three, you can't picture the future with your partner. You can't imagine what it's going to look 3 years from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now. They're just not even on your radar. Number four, you're planning for the end. You kind of have an exit strategy. Well, once the kids are off in middle school or high school, or once the kids are off to college, or you're thinking about, you know, if this happens, then I'm out. If they do this, then that's it. That's the last straw. You kind of set a deadline. You're physically unavailable to your partner. Communication has broken down. Number seven, you have changed. And maybe you're aware of, like, we all change. But we're not kind of talking about like a change for the better. You've changed for the worse. And you realize that instead of bringing out the better in one another, you only seem to be bringing out the worst. Number eight, you're an emotional wreck. And number nine, you spend less time together. You don't even want to be around them. You come up with other excuses, hobbies, pastimes, whatever it is, just so that you are not present, so you don't have to stay with them. And then, of course, the tenth one, you're keeping score. Some of you have been checking off this list, going, yep, he does that, she does that. I'm keeping a scorecard here, 4 out of 10, Pastor. They really need to come to this series, right? See, the reality is we are imperfect people. We all have a couple of these items that we could be working on, maybe multiple items that we could be working on in our relationships. And we recognize that where we are now doesn't necessarily always line up with where we thought we would be. So if we are honest, we probably could admit that there isn't a single person in this room that has not hurt someone they love. And there isn't a single person in this room that hasn't felt that sting of someone they love hurting them in return. And so we're just going to put it out there that we all have had those moments, right? We're not going to point fingers at anyone, especially if we're sitting next to them or preaching to them. I'm just kidding. We all have had those moments. And maybe things have gotten so bad that you've thought about that D word, or you've even thrown out the idea of getting a divorce or threatening to leave them. Maybe you've told yourself that you will never talk to your brother again. Oh, hi, Dwight. My brother's here today. And maybe you've kind of reached that point where it's like you're so tired of that one friend or that neighbor that made you so mad. It's like, that's it. That's the last time. I don't want to have anything to do with them. Maybe you've even thought about, or even maybe just joking around saying, you know what? I'm going to leave so-and-so out of my will. Right? Have you thrown that one at your kids before, or grandkids, and just as a little teaser? But sometimes those thoughts come where it's like, you know what? Why? Why am I going to be blessing to this person? Why am I going to do this good? But that doesn't mean we need to give up on the dream. That doesn't mean our curb appeal is gone. You see, curb appeal is more than just what we see on the outside. I know when we're talking about it in terms of houses, it's like the view from the street from afar, right? But curb appeal is so much more than what is going on the outside. Our curb appeal comes from the work that we put into our homes. We don't see how hard that person worked on their yard or how long it took to repaint the house or do the landscaping, right? There's a lot of work and a lot of effort that goes into that. We don't see the work that goes into investing in others and nurturing those relationships we love. Melissa and I have had our moments. We haven't always been on the same page or even in the same chapter, or as Pastor Melissa reminds me, sometimes we're not even reading the same book, right? Have you been there? That's her line. We have those moments in our life, right? But the more we keep working on our relationship, the more we invest time and energy and effort, and the more we reach out and learn and gain those tools, the stronger our connection becomes. And so whether you are single or married or divorced or widowed or not even thinking about that yet, I want you to know that you can have that curb appeal that you desire for your relationships. You can have that curb appeal you desire. You see, often when it comes to messages on marriage, we often boil God's word on marriage down to just three words. And I'm actually going to share it right now by reading this passage from Malachi chapter 2. And let's see if you can guess what most often, what three words are picked up on when we read, when it comes to God's thoughts on marriage. Malachi chapter 2, beginning verse 10 and following verses, it says, "Have we all not one Father? Did not one God create us? Why do we profane the covenant of our fathers by breaking faith with one another? Judah has broken faith. A detestable thing has been committed in Israel and in Jerusalem. Judah has desecrated the sanctuary of the Lord by marrying the daughter of a foreign god. Another thing you do, you flood the Lord's altar with tears. You weep and you wail, and he no longer pays attention to your offerings or accepts them with pleasure from your hands. And you ask why? Well, it is because the Lord is acting as the witness between you and the wife of your youth. Because you have broken faith with her, though she is your partner, the wife of your marriage covenant. Has not the Lord made them one? In flesh and spirit they are his. And why one? Because he was seeking godly offspring. So guard yourself in your spirit and do not break faith with the wife of your youth. I hate divorce, says the Lord, the God of Israel. And I hate man's covering himself with violence as well as with his garment, says the Lord Almighty. So guard yourself in spirit and do not break faith." So what three words do you think most sermons get boiled down to on marriage? Simply, God hates divorce, right? Have you heard that sermon preached before? I'll never forget, I was sitting in a preaching class and the professor decided, you know what, I'm going to give these students some difficult passages to preach on so we can see how they handle it, right? And so we're sitting there, we're working through some of these sermons, and I noticed that this young lady who was sitting in the across the aisle from me started crying. And not just like crying a little bit, but seriously crying. As this student who is preaching this message on marriage and how divorce is so evil, and what he didn't realize was her parents were in the middle of a very messy and public divorce. And it was bringing up all this pain, and it's almost like when we boil down God's word on marriage to just three simple words, God hates divorce, we kind of miss the point, don't we? We miss the point. And so many have stayed, because it kind of creates this message like the only thing God cares about is the fact that we stay together. But so many have stayed in unhealthy relationships because they thought, well, this must be what God desires. If God hates divorce, and if there's only one reason I can divorce my spouse, well, then I better stay in this relationship. And we think about it, we probably have known all the harm that has been done with such a view. But you see, God desires so much more for you than just staying in an unhealthy relationship, staying together for the sake of staying together. You see, it isn't that God hates divorce, it's that God loves marriage. And God loves your marriage, and God loves your relationship. God cares about healthy relationships. And I think when we focus on those three words, and just that's the only message we hear, we completely miss the point, don't we? You see, God's word, if you think about this, in the book of Genesis, it opens with a marriage. With Adam and Eve walking intimately, enjoying this close relationship with God in the garden. And if you go all the way over to the book of Revelation at the end of the Bible, you know what you find? A marriage. Where it says Jesus is awaiting the bride of Christ. And you know who the bride of Christ is? It is you. It is the church. It is all believers. Jesus is waiting for that perfect day where we will be united with him. And all throughout Scripture, all the Scriptures in between, when we are talking about marriage, there is a high regard to marriage because God often uses the marriage covenant as an illustration of his love and the covenant of love that he has established with us. And so, there's some pretty strong words when it comes to marriage, because it's to be a symbol of his love for us. That text from Malachi goes so much deeper than what many preachers have boiled it down to. If we think about it, it helps us understand the context of what's going on. Malachi was speaking to a people who had been displaced from Israel, right? They had been conquered. They had been sent off to different parts of the empire, and then they are returning home, and they're finding, guess what? Other people have moved into their town. And other people have established businesses, and there are other things going on. And so when they come back, there's these well-established trade guilds, these mercantile guilds. And the only way to get into them was to marry. And so these Israelites, when they return, they decide to divorce their Hebrew wives to marry a non-Hebrew wife in order to enter into these trade guilds. In other words, if you think about it, it was an economic transaction. They were divorcing and remarrying simply for economic reasons. Now, that kind of seems ridiculous, doesn't it? And yet, how do we view our marriages? Is it just a contract, like a legal joining of household? Or is it the covenant it was supposed to be? See, the Lord established marriage as a covenant. The Lord wasn't concerned about them so much about who they married. It was about the fact that he was concerned they were to be his chosen people, set apart from all the peoples of the land. And he understood that if they were to intermarry with these people that had some detestable practices of worship, that they eventually would turn their hearts away from the one true God and begin to worship idols that were powerless in their life. And so he was concerned about their hearts. He was concerned about their well-being. But sometimes we forget that marriage is a covenant. And we see it more like that contract, right? Some relationships function a little bit more like an economic contract. We're going to stay together simply for economic reasons, right? Like, if we enter into the relationship, maybe we move in together thinking, well, hey, you know what? If we live together, guess what? We can save 15% on our car insurance. By living together, by establishing this household, we can save some money on some bills, or we can save some money on rent. I know I'm probably stepping on some toes here, but when we think about it, what happens if our relationship is solely based on those economic reasons? What happens when it's no longer economically profitable? What happens when he or she loses their job? What happens when that income isn't so secure? Right? It would seem kind of foolish. I will stand with you as long as it is profitable for us. Like, no, that would be, who would want that partner, right? Sometimes our relationships function solely for like security or companionship. We'll stay together because it makes us feel safe and secure. The house isn't so empty. I don't feel so alone. But what happens when that security is threatened? What happens when a medical crisis comes, or we face a health scare, or somebody is left with a disability? Some relationships function solely for the purpose of raising kids. And sometimes our marriages go through this phase where it's like everything is centered around those kids, right? Or trying to manage the household and trying to figure out who needs to get from one place to the next place and who has what on what weekend. And it drives us insane almost. And before we know it, it seems like we're spending all of our time focusing on our kids that we no longer talk to each other. And sometimes it's easier to talk about what the kids are doing because we don't want to talk about the distance that is growing in our relationship. And sometimes we start to think ahead about that exit plan. But what happens when the kids are gone and we are left all alone with one another again? When God established marriage, he did so as a covenant, as a promise, as a commitment, demonstrating the love that he has for us. So the Lord calls the Israelites to a higher standard in their relationships because he understands they are to live their lives as a reflection of his love. The Lord had given them strict warnings about their relationships because he deeply cared about his people. He loves them. And he speaks strongly against divorce, not because he hates divorce, but to emphasize how much he loves marriage and how much he loves healthy relationships and how important this covenant is. You see, our curb appeal comes from God. Our curb appeal comes from God's love. We will have our struggles. We're well aware of our struggles, or at least we're well aware of our partner's struggles or our friend's struggles, right? But we also live in the middle. You see, we live our lives in the middle of what God has done in sending his Son to die for our sins, to redeem us by his grace. And we live in the middle of what God will do when he fully restores us one day and we are united with Christ in heaven. And here we are living our lives in the middle of God's grace. And it is that grace, that love, that we can share with others. It is God's love that needs to be in the middle of our lives. And when we make God's love central to our relationships, that is when we can see that curb appeal increase. When we make God's grace and love central to all of our relationships. You know what one of the greatest things about curb appeal is? It is contagious, isn't it? When one of us starts taking care of those things in our life, when you see one neighbor meticulously taking care of their dandelions, guess what? I'm motivated to go pick a few dandelions of my own, aren't I? The curb appeal is contagious. As I've worked on cleaning up our yard and restoring the lawn to good health, I've had conversations with my neighbors. And they've shared with me what they have done and what's worked with them. And I've shared with them what I was doing to improve the health of my lawn. And they've made referrals, and I've made referrals. And they've shared what they have learned with me, and I've shared what I am learning with them. They have lent me tools, like when my spreader for the fertilizer broke down, and I had 400 pounds of lime and gypsum and fertilizer and all kinds of stuff that I was planning to put on my lawn that weekend because it was going to rain and I was going to aerate. And my wonderful neighbor helped me out. And I've been able to lend out tools to my other neighbors to say, yeah, you want to aerate your lawn? Go ahead. I picked this thing up off of Facebook. Go ahead. You can use it. Use the riding lawnmower. Poke some holes. Drive slow. It's more effective. And we've done? We've increased the curb appeal of our entire street, haven't we? By helping one another out, by sharing what is going on in our life. Curb appeal is contagious. And we can do the same thing in our relationships, can't we? We can share what we've learned. We can share how we've grown through our struggles. We can share the tools that we've gained in the process and in the journey. And we can encourage others and learn from others and improve the health of all of our relationships. So what is your hope and dream for your relationship? What is that curb appeal that you are after? You know, maybe you are here today and you put in the hard work, the time to make your relationship as healthy as it can be. How can you share that to strengthen and increase the curb appeal of the neighborhood and the community around you? You see, we can have the curb appeal others are seeking. As Christians and making God's love central in our life, we can have that curb appeal that others desire. By making God's love central to our relationship, by committing ourselves to doing that hard work to really make our relationships thrive, and by sharing our story of how we've grown with others. Let us pray. God, we thank you that our curb appeal doesn't come solely from our own efforts, but from the love and the grace that you have shown us. And so, God, I pray that if there is anyone here today or listening today that is in need of your grace, maybe they're wandering and going, you know what, I've checked off multiple things on that relationship. I know that my relationship could use a little fixing up. God, I pray that you give them a word of encouragement and hope today. God, your word says that when we align our desires with your desires, that you are pleased to give us the desires of our heart. And so, Lord, we pray for that, for our relationships. We pray for healing. We pray for restoration. We pray for the encouragement we need to have that curb appeal that comes from you. God, I pray that you help us to take our friendships, to take our relationships, not for granted, but to really live them out to their fullest for your sake, that we might be a reflection of the love and the grace that you have shown us. And so, God, we thank you for this word. We pray that you would use this series for your honor and for your glory. I pray for all this, Lord, in your name. Amen. I'm going to invite our worship team to come and share our closing song with us this morning. We invite you to stand and to join. We hope that this service has been a blessing to you. We hope that you'll plan to join us next week. Pastor Melissa, is it this old house next week? I'm putting her on the spot, so I believe we're talking about this old house next week with Pastor Melissa bringing the passion to our service next week. And so make sure to invite a friend, hit that like button, the subscribe button to our YouTube channel, and we'll see you next week.
yard work done with the people that you love, and have a wonderful, blessed day.
Amen.